All right, let's start with one that's very basic and very fundamental, and most of you sitting here listening to me today will say, I don't have a problem in that area. But I can tell you, number one on your list must be physical security and what we will categorize as access control. We do audits all around the country, large companies, small companies, independents, chain stores, and forever I hear retailers tell me, we know who has keys, we have our back door secured, we know exactly who can get in and out at what times of the day. And I can also tell you, without exception, that in 8 out of 10 audits that we do, we find doors that are not controlled, points of entry or exit, where the doors can be opened because the panic alarms aren't working, or because they are just opened and they're not being monitored by a central alarm system. Now, some of you may have an excellent alarm system. You may really know exactly what you're doing with your access control. But if you don't, I urge, this is the first place we have to start. Access control, exactly what doors are available to be opened and closed, the alarms are working, are they wired? Access control, make sure that your doors cannot be opened and closed without your approval and or your knowledge during unauthorized hours of the day. So access control has to be number one, physical security, access control. That's your starting point. Let's talk about number two, one that everyone will understand immediately, and that is receiving. You know, you do it at McDonald's, you do it at the restaurants, make sure you get what you pay for. When you go through the line in a restaurant, you make sure they give you what it is you're paying for. At the back door, we have to be just as vigilant. We have to know that we get what we pay for. We're being charged for the correct item. We're being charged the correct price, and we're getting the correct quantity. Again, 7, 8, sometimes even 9 out of 10 audits that we do, we identify that vendors are counting the product, not the receiver. Now, you can tell me all day long, that's not our policy. It is our policy for our receivers to do the counting. I'm telling you, in 7 to 9 out of cases of audits that we conduct, we find at least 1, 2, 3 instances where the vendor is counting, the receiver is accepting that count. So that's number one. Let's go back, reinforce that. If you haven't had a backdoor receiver training session in months or even years, I suggest you take a look at our website and see our backdoor receiver training program for store managers and receivers. It's a great 1-2 punch way to revitalize your receiving. But that's not what I'm trying to tell you right now. What I also want you to do, this is May 1st. That means you have exactly 1 month before you are into summer season, summer vacation season. What's going to happen is your receivers, your regular receivers, are going to go on vacation. Your regular drivers are going to go on vacation. Both of those conditions set you up for theft. Temporary drivers who will try to take advantage of existing and or temporary receivers, and vice versa. So it's very, very important right now that you be thinking about training your backup receiver. In every single store, who is going to be my receiver during the summer months when my regular receivers are off, out of town, unavailable, on vacation? Start setting up now that training program, that orientation, know exactly who it's going to be and exactly how they're going to do their job, and know that they're being monitored to do that job correctly. Receiving is a basic point of control hub program for this month and every month going forward. Number three, cashier controls. We all know about cashier controls. I'm the founder and inventor of Shrink Tracks. I know cashier controls as well, I believe, as anybody. Not the point, though, of who I am or what I do. Cashier controls is a hub program. There are 7 key performance indicators that must be monitored on a regular basis. Those 7 or 8 items that have to be monitored should be on a regular report, consistently monitored weekly by the store manager, daily by the front end manager. And I'm not talking about monitored as in sit down, go over them, spend a lot of time. I'm talking very specifically about minute by minute, meaning it takes but minutes to monitor it on a daily basis. It takes but minutes to monitor it on a weekly basis. Cashier controls have to be in place consistently, executed on from a monitoring standpoint every single day, and the front-end manager, store manager, and every cashier has to be accountable to make sure that they're monitoring those numbers and in line with those numbers with whatever your store norm is. That's control point number three, cashier controls. The next one that I want to talk about is really also very important and so often not discussed. That is cash limits in your office. The question is this: do you have a policy for cash limits that says that on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, for example, your daily cash limits, those that amount of cash that you can have in your cash office between the hours of 8 a.m. and 5 p.m. is $10,000 in cash? Meaning that would be your level of exposure should you get robbed. $10,000 during the day, $7,000 at night. On Thursday and Friday and Saturday when business is up, that number may change. The policy may then be $10,000 during the day and $15,000 at night for check cashing purposes. The issue is cash limits. It's a hub program. It communicates many other points of control to everybody in your store. So it's important that your cash limits policy limit or mitigate your exposure and risk when in a robbery situation, but it also signals to every single employee that we are a store and a company under control. So cash limits is your point of control number four.